it germinates into the same tree once again, with the same likes and dislikes, with the same habituated trend of thinking. So the indweller exists along with the seed when the body is dropped. The body is only to provide soil for the seed. It is also part of the grain, part of the game. Understand the texture of the real I am and the false I am. When you take to an attitude of working with the real I am, that is the beginning. And that gives a change of all the values. It produces the attitude required in you, and the changed attitude will make you do your own actions. The same activity remains, but the attitude changes. And then you will be able to change the quality of the seed. Also, there comes a time when you will have a fried seed of your tendencies, a scorched. That is, a seed which fails to germinate hereafter. There is only the experience in its pure state, but the tendency to germinate into the cause and effect tree is gone. So your mind will not have any causes to stimulate it into action. And your mind will not have the good and bad of the results you receive. Then life becomes one with the total life. Your consciousness becomes one with the total consciousness. Though the body and the mind and senses exist, though the daily activity continues, it is a different experience. And the total consciousness exists in this constitution. Just as a little bottle when immersed in a river, when the bottle is rolling down in the bottom of the river, it has no difference between the water in the bottle and the water in the river. That is the change that takes place. Yes, that depends upon your own choice. That is, if you are too much interested in the present environment and the property or bank balances or the house or the husband, the children and their children, if it is very difficult for our minds when we are leaving this body, then there is an interval between one body and another body. The more the attachment is towards environment, the more will be the time interval between two reincarnations. And if the attachment is nil actually, the next birth is not yours. It is a requirement by nature. You will not be given, you will be given a birth, but you will not acquire the birth which is conditioned by your past deed. In that case, you will be a helper of this creation. And automatically, the next birth takes place. Because you are a helper and a server. And you are no more conditioning your own birth. And even your birth will not condition you. Because you are neither birth conditioned nor death conditioned after that stage. Spiritually speaking, it is said that you have neither birth nor death. That is called the eternal life. That does not mean we will not be having bodies and minds. But that means that our bodies and minds do not belong to us. They belong to the universal work. So the interval is decided by the individuals themselves, according to the strength of the adherence to the environment. Brothers and sisters who gather here, I find it somewhat interesting to give you the outlines of the science of Ayurveda and a comparison with the philosophy of homeopathy. Because now that here We have gathered here from France, Belgium, Switzerland or Germany. And that we have spiritualism as our background of everything else. And all those who have gathered here believe in the spiritualism as the basis of other things. So I think it's a bit opportune to explain a few interesting points about the philosophy of Ayurveda as compared with the philosophy of homeopathy, without making it too technical and without making it lengthy. That too, if you permit, I do it. Otherwise, if you question, I answer. So, let me know if you permit me to do it. Ayurveda is two words put together. The word Ayu means span of life. Veda means wisdom. So, it is defined as the wisdom of the span of life. So, the name indicates the purpose of the science. It is not predominantly a system of curing diseases, but is a science which gives you a proper understanding of what is life, what is span, and what are the conditions under which the span can be spent healthily. So you can say it is a science of span and a science of health. And also it speaks of our defaultations with our daily routine, how they cause disturbances in health, and what are the classifications of the disturbances, which we call diseases, and then how to use the minerals and the plants and the sounds in meditation to use for a cure. This is the total province of the science of Ayurveda. Just as we have the name homeopathy significant of the science. For example, homeo means the law of similars. Pathy means that which makes a science which makes a cure. So the name homeopathy signifies a cure according to the law of similars. Because we have the two methods of cure prevalent from the ancient days. The one is antipathy, the other is homeopathy. The first is attempting a cure by applying conditions that are of an opposite nature to those existing in the patient. For example, if a patient is cold in hands and feet, we apply heat and supplement the heat. And in tropical and hot countries, when a person is suffering of sunstroke, we give him some cool application, some cool drink. And when the temperature of a patient is too high, we apply ice to his face. This is what is called antipathy. That is applying measures that are of an opposite nature. And homeopathy is applying measures that are of a similar nature. For example, if you experiment a medicine with a healthy constitution, the application of medicine to healthy persons produces some disturbances in the health, and the mental plane, the vital plane and the physical plane. And when these disturbances are properly recorded, and if you find that group of disturbances in a patient, you can use that medicine to cure that patient, provided you know the dosage and the repetition. This is what is called the law of similars or homeopathy. If you make an attempt to cure through the homeopathic method, the system of cure is called homeopathy. Similarly, the word Ayurveda indicates the scope of the science. Both the sciences accept the theory of the existence of subtler bodies in us. For example, according to homeopathy, you can understand the human constitution like this. You have the outermost layer, which you call your physical body. Then you have the vital body. Then you have the mental body. Then you have the intellect. Then you have the logic. Then you have your will. Like this, layer after layer are existing in you. And finally, in the innermost layer, you have the layer of love, which the spiritualists call the I am of you. But generally, we are not capable of understanding the I am in its pure sense. We will get identified with any one of these layers. Many of us live as one, two, or three, or many of the other layers. So, by the word I am, we mean the I am along with the other layers. So, it is only the science of spiritualism, the science of the eightfold steps of yoga, and the scientific treatment of homeopathy, and the observation of the daily routine principles of Ayurveda, that make you experience the pure I am in you. So, many people, they know their physical body, and there are people who deny the existence of the other body. But as you go on advancing in evolution, you will begin to feel everything that is existing in you on the subtler planes. So, when a disease enters a human constitution, according to homeopathy, the disease attacks the innermost consciousness and then gradually descends step by step into the other layers. So, essentially, the mind and the higher principles of the human being are affected whenever a real disease attacks him. So, a real cure also is made in the same order. For example, in a long-standing disease, if you administer the right medicine according to homeopathy, the change should take place on the higher planes first. For example, if a person is having headache and also having a suicidal mania, headache belongs to the vital plane and suicidal mania belongs to the innermost plane because his love nature is distorted and the maximum love that is bestowed by nature is the love to live, that is natural with every living being on this earth. And unless the love to live is very strong, you cannot transmit the same to others. And you cannot very much desire that others also should live. So, when there is a distortion in the love nature, when a disease disturbs a person in the love nature, the love to live is disturbed and a logic is produced which makes him believe that it is reasonable to commit suicide. So, when the innermost core of the human being is affected, the person will be having suicidal mania. And If you give, administer the correct medicine to such a person, the change should first take place in the suicidal mania, not in the headache. If within a few weeks he is better in his suicidal mania, and if he is not better with his headaches, that means your treatment is going in the right lines. But if his headache is ameliorated and his mind is too restless to accept his life in his body, that means the treatment you have taken is a wrong one, that this drug you have selected is not the correct drug, and the betterment that is caused in the patient is going to create more and more complications, even though you have administered the correct medicine. If such a change occurs, that his headache is better and his suicidal mania is worse, that means his disease is beyond the scope of curability. As a verification, you can make an antidote of the medicine you have given and make repeated attempts at longer intervals to cure him. Whenever you make an attempt, it is only the headache that is getting better and not the suicidal mania. That definitely proves that the disease has crossed the possibility of curability. This takes place when the patient is going into diseases like cancer or gangrene or hydrothorax. That is incurable condition. But generally speaking, if he is better in the suicidal mania and still for some time not better in his headache, that means your cure is taking a correct direction. It has started to cure the centralmost layer. And after a few weeks, the medicine you have administered will reach the second layer, the vital force, set right the cause of the headache, and his migraines will be permanently cured. But remember, the whole course takes not less than 1 year, during which period you may not be required to repeat the medicine at all. The one dose or the two doses or three doses you have used in the year, according to the need of the same remedy in different dilutions, will drive off the headache permanently. So this is how homeopathy makes us understand the constitution, that is the existence of the subtler vehicles and the working of the vital matter, vital substance, which is of a dynamic nature. It also adds that the vital dynamis is always protecting our constitution. Even in our daily routine, if we have some little cuts or eruptions on the skin, the vital force is healing us. For example, sometimes we may have little wounds, little cut, or sometimes we may take off the nail into the gum. Sometimes there may be little bleeding. Automatically, within the 2 or 3 days, there will be a healing of the skin, which makes you understand that there is a subtler force that is always working in you. And whenever we default with anything in the world, this subtler force is protecting us from the results of the defaultation. For example, if I eat too much in a dinner, I feel the discomfort of it. The discomfort is not a disease in any way. The vital force has two meanings to produce the discomfort. One is to teach us that we should not repeat the experiment. The second thing is that the vital force is making a fight with the unnecessary matter that is produced into the body. And it is applying more calories of energy upon that particular point, so that it can exert all its ability to expel the unnecessary material soon and set the constitution once again in normal condition. In this process, the vital force may produce sometimes diarrheas. So, we should not understand that the diarrhea is a disease. It is the attempt of the vital force to fight the undesirable conditions. Similarly, whenever there is a poisoning in the body, we have many violent actions. For example, nausea and vomiting, some foaming and frothing in the mouth, sometimes too much of salivation, sometimes sweating. All these are wrongly understood as the effects of the poison. They are not at all the qualities of the poison. The quality of the poison is only to kill silently. But all this violence belongs to your vital force which is fighting the poison out. It is trying to save the constitution by expelling the poisonous effects through as many methods as possible. If it succeeds, the constitution survives. If the strength of the poison is more, the vital force has to accept the defeat, and the result is death. That is what is happening. So every moment, day and night, the vital force is protecting us. Even while we are sleeping, it is making us respire. It is keeping our heartbeat and circulation. It is keeping up our digestion and other functions. So there is no question of not accepting the vital, the subtler bodies in us. The vital body of homeopathy is called the etheric body by the spiritualists. So this is some understanding of the homeopathic physiology. Now let us compare it with the physiology of Ayurveda. There is the physical body, it is called body of matter. In Sanskrit it is called Annamaya. Anna means matter and Annamaya means material body. The second is the vital body of the homeopathy. The second is called in Sanskrit Pranamaya. Prana. Prana means vital force and also the vital pulsation. It is taught in the Ayurveda that we have a body of pulsations in us that is maintaining the body of matter. There is a third layer which is the mental body. In Sanskrit, in Ayurveda it is called Manomaya. Mano means mind, Manomaya means mental body. There is the fourth layer, which is called the layer of consciousness. It is called Vijnanamaya. Vijnana means the intelligence. Not only the intelligence that is working in your mind, but also the intelligence that is working in every cell of your body, governing the various functions of the parts of the body. And the intelligence which knows all the sciences in nature. For example, even though you do not know chemistry, this intelligence of the lungs makes you only to inhale oxygen and exhale carbon dioxide. It has nothing to do with our knowledge of oxygen or carbon dioxide. Similarly, with all the thousands of sciences that exist in nature. So, the intelligence that is working in your constitution, it knows all the thousands of sciences that are existing in nature. Though the intelligence that is working through our mind may be knowing very little number of sciences. So that is the fourth layer. And there is the fifth and the final layer, which is said the layer of experience. In Sanskrit, it is called Anandamaya. Ananda means experience or bliss. Bliss. This is the rough understanding of the constitution. The constitution of any biological being. You will understand here that all the remaining four bodies, the physical, vital, mental and the consciousness, they are made up of the substance of the fifth one called the Ananda.